All right, so, fuck yes. Welcome to After Time. With me, as always, is Jonathan Harrison.
That'd be me.
Emily Blake.
That'd be me.
And still nobody else, because they both can't be here. But one of them did write a review for the movie, which I'll read.
I'm guessing that was Chewy.
It was definitely Chewy. She just sent it to me via text, so we'll count
that. That is on brand.
Yeah. And then we have a special guest back from Geostorm, the
Geostorm.
Classic. We have Beth Hanley here.
Hi.
Or do you prefer Elizabeth Hanley?
Either. I'll okay. answer to just about anything.
I don't know if it's like a professional, like I need to be known by this name.
No, okay. I don't care.
Well, I'm leaving all that wonderfulness in. That's what we call quality podcasting. So we're still in horror month here. We're trudging along as if we've been stalked by a murderer, which is actually more apt to this movie than any of the other movies we've talked about in our horror month. This week we're talking about Tragedy Girls, but we'll get there after we do a nice Where Have You Been Doing? And I can go first, and I will keep this as short as humanly possible because I can talk about this for hours. I've become so obsessed with it, along with the rest of the world, and I'm really late to the game. Great British Bake Off. It is so fucking good, and I don't even know how to describe why it's so good, because I don't like reality TV. I don't like getting sucked into like these people who are like real people, and it's like, no, you're fucking not. And like this like fake arguments and all this, like I don't like reality TV because I don't like the branding of reality, because it's just not. They're basically just game shows, and that's always like my thing. It's like, all right, just call it a game show, because that's what it is. Like, Survivor is a game show. It's not reality TV. There's a prize at the fucking end. It's a game show.
Well, I think that's why Survivor can last as long, because they have kind of embraced that they are a game show.
Exactly.
Like, we are a social game show, and that's what we are.
And the thing I like about Great British Bake Off, and why I'll try to keep this short, is because it's just a nice show. Like, they don't encourage being mean to each other. They don't encourage fucking each other over or getting drunk to be on the air, like certain shows I won't mention because that's not a good idea. But like they do a lot of they encourage people to be nice to each other. Like when you have like one baker who's like really struggling, she's like, I don't know how I'm going to get this done. And the other guy will turn around and is like, well, I just put mine in the oven. I got 20 minutes. You need some help? And you'll see them helping each other. It's like,
that's awesome.
It does the five minutes.
And it's just like, you guys are just so British and fucking polite. And it's just like,
well, I think that's it. Cause out of the 5 minutes I've seen, everything was so anti-reality TV.
Yeah.
And every decision they made aesthetically.
It's just like eventually somebody does get voted off every episode, but it's not like you're no longer fit to be on this thing. It's like, sorry, we just don't have space.
You've been chopped. It's more like you didn't do well enough, and everyone else did so good. You all did so really good.
Yeah, and it's like, and the first thing is like, sorry, you're not on the show anymore. And then they run over and give them like a big hug, and everybody's crying. And then at the end, like they go to the judges, like, we're so sad we had to get rid of them because they're such good bakers. We just don't have space for them anymore. And it's like, I love this show. Like, I am so into this.
This is like, normally I put the TV on while I'm sewing.
Yep.
And normally I just put on MSNBC, but lately I just want to murder everything. By the time I'm like making the costume, I'll just stab the fabric. This sounds like a great alternative to that. Like, I don't think I'll be as enraged watching it.
Honestly, that's why I got into it, because I started watching it when all the Kavanaugh bullshit started, and I'm like, I was watching American Horror Story, I'm like, I just need something nice in my life, and everyone told me this one was nice, and there's, I think, 6 seasons on Netflix, and I blew through 5 of them in like 4 days.
Oh, wow.
Whoa.
And now I just have the other one, just like, I can't watch it, because if I watch it, it'll be over, so I just, I'll just save that one for a little while.
Are you going to look into BritBox?
I don't know.
I just got BritBox. All
is
the
it
Doctor
worth it?
Who's are the, well, I'm only watching Doctor Who on
okay.
it, but yeah, it's got almost, it's got most of them, most of the Doctor Who's. It's supposed, I think it has Red Dwarf, it has other stuff, but I've really just been watching it for Doctor Who.
Okay.
It's only like $6.99 a month.
And I think it was a lot. I'm thinking about it. I don't know.
I'll let you know what else is there.
Yeah, because I just got the DC Universe because I'm that guy, and I'm not sure if I can buy another streaming service on top of that one. I will say this, it's not my Where Have You Been Doing, but watching Linda Carter's Wonder Woman again has been like the joy of my life lately, because it's like, she was so fucking good. This show
so
was
good.
Awesome.
Her body is ridiculous. It's
still ridiculous.
Perfect.
Like,
yeah.
That woman is incredible. Fucking Linda Carter, man. That's it for me, though.
I watched a Chinese film called Golden Job, and...
Goldman Job?
Golden. Goldman. It's a Chinese Jewish movie.
I was like, what?
Golden Job. And not the Golden Job, just Golden Job. It is apparently these dudes back in the Hong Kong action era, just the tail end of it, there were these guys who were in all these little heist movies together. And then China took back over Hong Kong and censorship came in. And so now they don't really make those movies anymore. So this was kind of a throwback. It was still censored all to hell, but it was very much an action movie in sort of somewhat of a Hong Kong tradition. It was okay. It was enjoyable in the way that I find Battleship enjoyable, and that it was really, really fun to watch and highly entertaining. It is not what I would call a good movie. It is a very entertaining movie. It's very violent. The action scenes are killer. These dudes have some fucking slick moves. They look super cool. It's basically like The Expendables, where they're so cool doing everything, but like the story doesn't really hold up. And the biggest problem with this movie is shit is explained like after you needed to know it. Constantly, like all the time through the movie, something will happen, and then they'll be like, oh yes, we knew that because, and then they'll show a flashback to something, and you're like, well, that you can't just change shit and then show us that it happened earlier. Anyway,
that's totally how I introduce people to each other. Right? I talk about everything they've done, like, who is this? Oh, have you met so-and-so?
Yeah, like the whole movie's that way. Or just little decisions, like there's a character who ends up in a wheelchair, and it's presented as this super, super sad thing that this person's in a wheelchair. But every single scene where we've seen that person, he's been sitting down. So it's like, why? I'm not sad. He looks exactly like he did in every other scene. So he's never standing up. So, and then like the human carnage, in action scenes, like they have cars like there's one scene, there's a great car chase, but during this car chase, like the car starts smashing into like just innocent people's cars. Our heroes are just like smashing into innocent people's cars. And it's fine. Like a car will get in a wreck and then go over here, and another car gets in a wreck and go over here. And then they smash into a car that just fucking got obliterated. Like it blew the fuck up. And I'm like, there was somebody driving that car, and no one
going to work.
No one
kind of
like
dull today, and
there's
boom.
Never an examination of that. You never see the victim. It's just the car is destroyed, and it's not the only. They are just constantly.
You've seen The Raid too, right? Like
yeah,
but that car chase is just everyone but the characters
right?
die.
Yeah, right? But it's like
died too.
We were sitting there like every time there's some like bystander carnage, we just kept holding our hands up like what the fuck? Like they're so careless. It was I highly recommend it. Don't like if you just want to watch a dumb movie that is just explosions. It's very, like I said, it's Expendables-y. Lots of car chases, lots of fight scenes. There was really, really fucking cool scene where I was just like, that was awesome! But yeah, I found it entertaining. It is not a good film.
John, what about you?
So on kind of brand with what movie we're talking about high schoolers with a cool stylistic.
Persona 5?
Persona 5. Brian loaned me his copy of Persona 5, and I can't get enough of it. Unfortunately, I've had to not play it because of work things, but I've always looked at the copy of the disc like longingly. That thing is so much fun to play, and my jam in terms of JRPG goodness and like high schoolers like fighting demons and changing people's hearts through dungeons and it gets so anime that it's just a wonderful experience.
It's the best game.
Yeah, it's a favorite. And I'm so, like, in the beginning of it. Everyone I've talked to, like, oh, you've got so much more for it. And I just, like, oh, yes, I like that. I want to live in this game for a while.
I don't even know who Haru is yet.
Yeah.
Haru is awesome.
I haven't even met all the characters.
Beth, what about you?
So, I am not a traditional seasonal watcher of American Horror Story. I tried watching, like, Coven. And I tried watching, like, Murder House. And every time I'd hit episode one, I'd be like, this is not the show for me, and just tuned out. And then this season, I was like, ugh, that concept looks really interesting. So I put it on, and I made a deal with my husband. I was like, let's do it episode by episode. And like, if we fall out, fine, whatever. But so far, they have held my attention. It's very pretty to look at. And at the end of every episode, I'm like, wait, what? No, there needs to be more. Fill in the gap still. I'm interested. So it only took them 8 seasons, but now I'm interested.
Did you watch Hotel?
No.
I just, the episode before this one, last week's episode, if you will, I ranted and raved about how good Hotel was.
Okay.
I really liked Hotel, but I'm really into melodrama. Like, if you're not into melodrama, you won't like it. It's basically a soap opera.
Hotel's the only one all of my friends are like, well, you should watch it. And I was like, but Gaga's in it?
It has sold me on Gaga as an actress.
I don't think that's a selling point.
I would have agreed with you unless I watched it. But having watched it, I'm like, nope, I like her.
I mean, this last episode, they even go to the hotel.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, oh, maybe I should watch this. I don't know. I'm still very on the fence. But so far this season, I'm in.
Fair enough. All right. Is that it for everybody? We good? We're going to start talking about tragedies. Lots and lots and lots and lots
just
and lots.
Murder everywhere.
Like a fucking murder central.
And the cops are the
worst. Worst cops in horror movie history.
Oh, so good.
So we're talking Tragedy Girls, which is a movie that I have a strong feeling that many of you listening today have not seen yet, even though I told you all to watch it last week.
You had ample warning.
You had ample warning.
We're a weekly podcast. You have about 7 days.
It's on Hulu,
It's on
guys.
Hulu for free. It's a movie that not a lot of people saw. The only reason I heard about it was because I wanted to see what Negasonic Teenage Warhead did outside of being Negasonic Teenage Warhead. And I'm like, that's where I found this movie. And
she hooked up with Storm. Yeah. They became best friends.
It worked out.
That would be funny. This is like X-Men, the early years.
Kind of is. They are crazy and they kill a bunch of people. Wait, just like
is
the
that
X-Men
the same actress?
Yeah.
Storm
damn,
and...
Damn. Okay, I didn't catch that.
Yeah.
Mind blown.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a sequel. Yeah. Totally.
I love it. Cool. But yeah, it didn't make a lot of money. It didn't make a huge splash, but it had some positive rumblings and not... I don't think enough people saw it is my end of that.
I never even heard of it until this came up on the list.
Again, if I wasn't curious about what the actress had done, I never would have heard it until Beth told us to watch it. So
you guys are welcome.
Yeah.
All right.
So coming from, since she couldn't be here today and it was really last minute, I'll give you the one review. I'm not going to talk numbers. It made no money. But this is Chewy's review because she really wanted to talk about it. So it's very, very short. She says, I enjoyed it. I love the fashion and the design with the hyper appearance of red and themes like Titanic. But I wish they had pushed it further and had not had the conflict center around feelings about a boy.
Hmm.
And that was Chewy's take on the movie. But before we dive into it, here we have to do a breakdown. Coming to you this week from Beth.
Mine's really short, just FYI.
Well, you have 30
Pretty
seconds.
Simple plot.
Yeah. Right? If you couldn't, last week we did Hereditary, and that one's a tough one to do in 30 seconds.
Mm-mm.
This one's much easier to do in 30 seconds. So here we go. Tragedy Girls in 30-ish seconds. Go, 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 go.
Okay, it's the story of two best friends who do everything together. They're on prom committee, they run a blog and social media together, they're cheerleaders, and they murder together. That's it.
How does it end?
The way all good friendships do, they go to college together.
Okay, that works. Yeah, you had 11 seconds to spare. I think you did pretty well.
Boom!
So for a movie like this one that we didn't really, like, not everybody even at the table had heard of it, and you were a big fan of it, what brought you to this movie? Like, why was this the movie, when you could choose a movie to talk about on the show, why was this the one?
Okay, so I don't know what you guys like to do in your spare time, but I like to scan...
Murder people?
I was going to go with movie trailers.
Okay.
And I watch, like, even the, like, indie and obscure ones, just so I can get, like, a flavor for what's coming out. And I remembered the trailer coming out, but it never hit a theater near me.
Yeah.
And so when I saw it available on Hulu, I was like, oh, okay. I watched it and went directly to your wife and was like, have you seen this movie? Because this movie is spectacular and we need to discuss it. And then she was like, that sounds like a good October show. I was like, yeah, it does. And that's what happened.
Okay. Was there anything like special about this movie that like rang for you more though, like more than other horror movies?
Yeah. It was the two women were in the lead roles doing all the slicing and dicing and murdering.
That's fair.
You rarely get to see that. And even though there is like inner fighting over something real stupid, their friendship still rings true in the end. And I was like, that's fucking beautiful.
It's one of those things where it still rings true in the end, and the fight didn't feel out of place for me.
No, they're 17-year-old girls in high school.
Yeah.
They're not 33-year-old women who should be over something like that by now.
It's one of those things where like I agree with Chewie's argument about it of like, it might have been better just to have them like have like an external conflict instead of like an internal conflict of like, I like this boy, but I think you should kill him. Like, it was just a little... I feel like the writing could have been a little bit stronger there if they'd gone for something. Like maybe Kimi could have been more of an outside force. Kimi is the original killer that they kidnapped.
Yeah.
I don't know the actor's real name. His name is Kimi in Lost, so he is always Kimi.
He's a brilliant character actor. He's been in a lot of shit.
Yeah, as Kimi from Lost. No. I mentioned this before we started recording. I'll mention it here. I have a theory that anyone who was in Lost at any time is now just their character from Lost in all medium, and this is just a different point in their life. Like Ant-Man and Wasp, that's Kate from Lost.
We are living
just
in
when she was Wasp.
We are living in like a whole transmedia experience.
Yeah, like
based off of Lost.
Lost is
everything. I mean, it makes sense. These are the flashbacks we didn't see.
Exactly. Yeah. Since Lost did that, my theory can work for everything.
So this is the time between the island and the church, is what you're saying?
It could be.
There should be a podcast where you connect those dots.
That's way too much work.
We copyrighted that idea, by the way.
But you're right. He is a very good actor. And like, I really like it whenever he shows up because he's played a good guy, I want to say, like, twice. Like, he usually plays a bad guy. And
a
like,
psycho. He plays a great psycho.
And he does it so well.
Mm-hmm. With joy. You can tell.
Yeah, you can tell he's having, like, every role he has, you can see that he's not phoning it in. He's giving it his all, but he's enjoying his work. And, like, I always like that with an actor. Like, you don't need to, like, it doesn't take you out of his character or out of the scene or anything, but when you can see they love what they do, it kind of makes it a little bit more fun. And you get that from him every time.
And I think what is kind of cool is that it's not just him doing that. Like, when you say he's chewing the scenery, having a good time, like, it would be something if it was just him doing that, but the two leads do that as well. And they
this movie's nothing. Like, the scenery is gone. Yeah. Everybody has chewed the fuck
this
out.
This movie is ABC.
By the way, his name is Kevin Durant, the actor, who's Kimi.
Kimi, thank you. Okay, yeah. Kimi, I got it.
No, that's the first thing that stood out to me the most is just the chewing.
Yeah.
That
happened in this
definitely,
movie.
That's what I loved about this movie is its tonal. Well, it loses it for a little bit in the middle, but by and large, the movie has this great playful tone that's really enjoyable.
Yeah, and I think that's where I kind of agree with Chewie, where I feel like it was like, to use Spinal Tap, I feel like they dialed it to 10 and they should have gone to 11. Like, it was just crazy enough to be fun and exciting and a really enjoyable movie. Whereas I feel like if they just went like one notch farther, which they do from time to time, like when they kill the cheer captain, I feel like that's where like it, or even when they kill Craig Robinson, like when they do those sorts of things, it's like, this is the movie that I want the whole way through. This just kind of like, fuck reality. Like, that doesn't make sense in this movie at all. And like, they do it from time to time. I kind of wish. It felt like it was on the fence of insanity. And
it needed another victim that was crazier than the two that surround. Like,
yeah.
It misses that middle victim that could have.
No. Are you kidding me? Mayor on a flagpole? How did he even get her up there?
But
they really gloss over that really fast.
That's the thing. Like, it's like one of those things where until you just said it, I forgot about that kill.
I did.
But that's not even their kill. That's his kill.
But like, I wish the movie just had a little bit more of that flair. And I don't think it's the movie's fault. I think it's probably more budgetary than anything else.
Yeah.
It's clear. Right. Like, it's definitely a low budget film.
Who had like big name actors who you can tell sashayed in for 3 days.
Yep.
Put in their best.
Just
and then out.
Josh Hutson, that's who I was thinking of.
The best.
So good.
So good. I loved that they put that like music tone behind him every time they wanted him to look dreamy. And that must have been so much fun on set for him to just like put that on and just be like, hey.
Just super, you know, like, douche it up.
Super
and
douche it up.
And just know what he's doing and feel it on the inside. Yeah.
I love that he was still like, I'm glad it was you.
And
she kisses him.
But like, I think that's my major thing why like I won't buy this movie is because I want that tone throughout the whole thing. And I feel like when it's not the murder scenes, it loses it.
Yeah.
And it takes a not just like a slight step back. It takes a big step back. And
yeah,
it's like,
it becomes a more normal movie.
Yeah.
Did you not love, though, her father being like, have you seen the cat? And then later complaining that all of the animals are going missing.
I did like those. I kind of jumping around like my points here. When you said it had like a really good cast, I think the script proves why it has a really good cast. Cause like when you send that script to somebody, it's way easier to get these people to show up for a few days. Cause it's such a just fun script.
Agreed.
And like the whole, like they mentioned earlier, like that, did you ever try that whole thing from Breaking Bad? It totally works. Like we had to kill so many animals though, to get the mixture right.
Yeah.
And now the rest of the movie, you have the running gag of, have you seen our cat? Nope. And all of the animals are missing. Like, I love that they keep hitting it, and it's like, oh yeah, they definitely killed all the animals in the town. And it's like, and like that's what I mean. Like, the script is so good that I can see why they got all these other people just to show up just for a little while. Because it's just like, who was the filmmaker in this? I never even looked up their name. Did anybody look up their name?
No, of course not.
See, what happened was the end credits were so flashy that I forgot to read the text.
Let me just look it up.
Tyler McIntyre is the director.
Oh, okay. So it's did he write it as well?
He is listed as a co-writer.
Okay. So like you can tell that they wanted to give Tyler a shot. Like, it's one of those things where, like...
Assuming Tyler was a man.
Yeah.
Which it may not be. Let me see.
It may not be. Give them a shot. When you have something that good and, like, that just kind of, like, crackles on the page, like, you can get people to give you a little bit more leeway, which is always kind of nice to see. Especially with a movie like this. Because, like, when you're sitting... Like, when you're on set for a movie like this, which I have been a couple times, like, no one's going to see this fucking thing. And it's like...
Well, you just know. Like,
yeah. And it's like, you're like, we're making something cool here that hopefully there's an audience for. Like, maybe, like, midnight screenings at, like, an Alamo Draft House. Like, something like that. Maybe we'll get somebody.
That would be awesome.
But, it is a man. He was an editor, which explains something.
That explains a lot.
Yeah. But it's like one of the, like, okay. So we hope that people will gravitate towards it. We hope it does well. But we all know what we're making here. And, like, I like watching those movies. It's the type of trailers that you talk about that you find on Hulu. Like, I like finding those and giving those a shot. That's why I watched... Last Girl Standing a years ago, and that's what I was afraid this was going to be like, because Last Girl Standing was great idea, horrible movie, and this one was great idea, really good movie.
Last Girl Standing,
just a brief aside, was a movie about a girl who went through, like, a Friday the 13th-esque extravaganza, and she was the last girl, and it's about her after that event and how it horribly ruined her psyche and how she becomes the
Hard
killer
pass.
And it was like, that was a really cool idea executed terribly. Mm-hmm. And it's like, this one was a really good idea executed really well, and I feel like it just needed, like, an extra bump in the budget and it would have been my favorite movie of the year.
But I mean, it's a movie like this is why you would explore movies that you've never seen before. Like, it gives a good it gives the good argument for check out something just, you know, that you haven't seen or heard of before.
Yeah, it's like the best movie I've had in a while where someone's like, just give it a shot, and it's like, no, it's great.
And it's tough with, like, the horror genre, because, you know, I troll, like, the streaming services like Netflix and all that, and I look for these types of things. There's more often than not, I'll want fun comedy with the horror bent, and sometimes, you know, I want the other stuff, but I'm looking
but
for these types of,
like,
movies.
Yeah, you get things like Babysitter, which is like, it's okay.
Which is fine. Yeah.
And it's McG. Your expectations are pretty low, but it's like...
Well, and they're met. The expectations are there, and they're met.
Yeah.
And this, where it's like, there's an expectation, and it, on its fun level, exceeds it. My expectations of this were exceeded.
Yeah,
Hurt though that you probably had no idea what you were going into when you went into it.
True, very true.
Yeah, I didn't watch the trailer or anything. I just launched it.
I feel like a trailer would have done a disservice almost.
The trailer actually isn't that bad for it. Like, the only thing that it does, and even, like, Hulu does this, is they give away the ending. Like, they give away that last shot of the girls in the masks with the doors on fire with all, like, the hands on it.
Oh, okay.
They give that away, and
but
it's like,
in a trailer, you might assume, like, maybe that's a dream.
Yeah,
something like that. You don't necessarily know it's the end. Although, if you start watching the movie, then you're like, oh, that's the ending.
Yeah, that was more of where I was. It was like, by about halfway point, I'm like, oh, okay, so that's the ending.
I see where we're going.
Yeah, I know where this ends. So, like, I know that one isn't going to kill the other. I know their friendship's going to mend. Like, I know these sorts of things are going to happen.
It lasts forever. Psychos.
The only thing that I think, jumping back more into the movie than just kind of how we feel about it, the thing that I really wish was in this movie more was a relationship between Kimi and Storm. Terrible with character names.
It works. This movie would appreciate that you're doing that.
But, like, that we get such a brief glimpse of it, like, in the limo, and then when they're talking about killing Negasonic Teenage Warhead's boyfriend.
Also when he, like, first tries to convince her to turn
into
her friend. That's where it starts.
That moment's fantastic, though, when she's crying, laughing, and then just, like, go fuck yourself.
Except it worked, though.
I feel like she was still in control the whole time, because
even
at the end of the movie, she's like, what did I say? We're not killing her. Mm. And when he wouldn't listen, he was done.
That's true. Yeah. And the thing is, like, kind of like I was saying last week's movie, where, like, I thought nothing of that actor in Jumanji, and then I loved him in Hereditary. When this girl played Storm, I couldn't even barely remember that she, like, it was like, oh, that was just the person in the role. Like, she didn't really bring anything to it. The movie didn't allow her to. It wasn't her fault.
Those movies are famous for not letting Storm do anything.
I know.
Exactly.
What is the deal? Why can't they make Storm good?
Storm is one of the greatest combo characters of all time, and they don't
She's
let her
one
do
of those powerful.
Shit. Yeah.
She's got
different
godlike
argument.
Power.
Yeah. No.
Different argument for a different
We're
day.
All on the same page, but we got to get back to this page.
So, seeing her here, like, it was really nice, because it's the same thing kind of like with the other actress. It's like, they're so, like, tied into this, like, very specific, kind of not easy role to play, but, like, you have, like, one thing to do. And then they give them this movie, and they both have, like, the range of emotions they both have to show in this movie while being this kind of, like, casual murderer is impressive. I thought they both were fantastic.
Well, it's like they toe a line, too, because you could take this, you could have someone in a lesser skill make these two characters annoying. Mm-hmm. That's what with these kind of higher stylized scripts, the person you cast matters so much, because those two girls could have been just one note.
They could have been the girl from the Purge movie who's just like, or they I'm here to kill.
Right.
They could have been the girls from Knock Knock, and it's just like,
It seems like, just based off of watching this and seeing the others, that seems to like it's an easy choice to make and a difficult one to avoid. So like,
yeah,
props.
And they did great. Like, and that's the thing with a movie like this, when like your budget's low, like you're like, obviously they had to shoot this thing real fast. Like, there's a lot of things that could hurt. And when you get a cast that solid, like it makes everything better. And these two girls were phenomenal from the whole movie, I thought.
Well, it's funny that you mentioned that the filmmaker was an editor originally, because then it's like, okay, they're picking the best takes for that performance too. And it's very interesting to kind of see it that way.
Yeah.
And usually when editors direct, they shoot less a lot of times because they already know what they want the cut to look like, so they don't overshoot. So it means he probably had a really good idea what everything was going to look like before he even started shooting. And so, you know, the choices were very specific, would be my guess.
Yeah. I mean, I would assume so. I didn't watch any behind the scenes or any like special features or anything on this one, so I really just kind of have what I'm bringing to the table. But that would make sense. Like, I would totally buy that.
Well, and for something as low budget as this, you have to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Otherwise, this movie doesn't result from that lack of preparation. And
it's the perfect movie, I think, for like whatever he does next. It's like this is the great calling card of like, hey, look what I can do. And I hope it works out for him. I haven't looked into what he's doing next, if he has anything on the table. But like, I'm interested. I'm definitely interested in what these people move on to do. But let's move around a little bit. Let's actually talk about the girls. Let's start with, I'm going to actually look up their names so I stop being horrible to them. As much as I just want to call her Negasonic Teenage Warhead, because that's such an awesome name.
She was fully unrecognizable the first time I saw this movie, and I looked it up on IMDb, and my brain exploded into 1,000 pieces. Even though the haircut is almost exactly the same,
right?
It's just blonde instead, because she looks great with a pixie cut. Mm-hmm. I was just like, oh shit, that's the same girl? Really?
Yep.
Like, way to go. Her range is pretty spectacular.
Brianna Hildebrand, I think her name is, if I can pronounce that last name correctly. I have no idea. She was one of those people, like, when she showed up in Deadpool, I'm like, she's funny. Kind of it. And it's like again, much like with Storm, I don't blame her. They didn't really give her anything to do.
Like that.
She scowled in the first Deadpool. Like, that's what they gave her to do, and they made the comedy around that.
Yeah.
Not anything that she did. Just stay still and frown and we'll make you funny.
And that's honestly, that's why I started looking her up. I'm like, you don't end up in a tentpole movie like this if you're just good at scowling. Like, clearly you had to audition. You had to prove that you can act and whatnot. So like, where else would she go? And that's how I ended up here. I brought her up first because I think, and I'll let you guys tell me I'm wrong here if that's the case.
You are fucking wrong, Brian.
Thank you. I can always count on you. I feel like her character is annoyingly inconsistent. And that's my biggest thing in the movie, because she is, they even talk about it. Like, it's even a point in the movie that she's annoyingly inconsistent. So it might not be a problem, but I don't like the whole, she is murder crazy. Like, she is the one who actually kills the guy in the beginning of the movie, which I won't ruin my line here because it's awesome. But like, she's just so pro murder. Like, yeah, I'm good. Let's do it. And then she softens so much just because a boy likes her, I think. And even that isn't really like, it's more so just because she didn't want to kill him, and then she gets famous, and I didn't buy the turn because she was so knuckin' futz to go to just like, I'm kind of okay now. Like, it just bumped me wrong.
There wasn't a build up to that. There wasn't a her ever questioning that whether or not what they were doing was wrong. She just, she went right from I love murder to, oh, I don't want to kill this guy.
Ended with I'm not going to kill anyone.
Yeah.
Because she stopped killing that guy, and then
suddenly she realized she could get famous for saving people instead of murdering people.
Which is a good idea that I don't think they really fully explored. They just kind of say it in a few lines of dialogue, and it's not really there.
Yeah. I mean, I don't... Again, I go back to, but, like, she's a 17-year-old girl, though.
Sure, yeah.
So, I feel like initially their idea was to get attention in the one way they felt they were confident to get attention. And then when the coin turns and she's able to get attention some other way, it does feel a little realistic to a certain extent that a 17-year-old girl would be like, okay, I'll ride this train too.
I would agree with that if it wasn't for the whole killing the boy's mom. Because they didn't do that for attention. They did that because they wanted to.
That was a thrill kill. That distracted me
a
little bit.
Also, can we just, the boy overheard that, and it didn't, like, he completely ignored the fact that she participated in it. He was
he says, like, I don't hold you accountable for that.
I know.
And you're just like, double standard much?
Yeah.
Here's the thing on that, and, like, it's kind of how you say, like, 17-year-old girl. I go with, like, I don't know, 17-year-old boy.
Uh-huh.
Oh man, she's so pretty. She couldn't be mean.
Yeah,
she likes me. That means she's not.
There's
got
to be some. There's got to be more to it than yeah. just. Yeah. There's got to be more.
Like, I can save her with yeah. this murder yes. problem yeah. she has.
Yes.
We can do that too.
And that character, like, he played that character perfect. Yeah. Like, he nailed that whole, like, no. I like this one, so she's not evil. And it's like, they just talked about how she was the one who wanted to kill your mom, and you just breezed over that.
See the real you.
Yeah.
No, you don't.
You don't want to do this.
In the flashback, they kill her together, don't they? Like,
it's like
shoelaces around her neck while she's driving.
They do it together, but they make it seem like it was Sadie's idea.
Yeah.
And MK was just more along for the ride. And it was like, and as they got older and more into murder, it kind of felt like that was shifting. But since it was Sadie's choice to begin with, she was still the driving force, even though
Michaela was more clearly the planner, and MK is more the action person.
I think it was interesting that, I guess that was MK's character arc, was going from being in the, you know, the secondary person who was following into being the one who brought the murderer to the party and was like, this is my show now. And it was like, oh, look at you. You figured it out.
She's able to plan the whole prom thing mostly by herself at that point.
She became a better murderer in the end. That was pretty good.
Yeah, maybe that was Sadie's whole plan. Like, you need to step up your game. I'm going to step away. You're going to train.
I just I don't feel like that was really Sadie's intention.
Well, that was my first thought when I saw it, like, when I got kind of pulled out of that moment, like, that turn. I was like, I was trying to kind of rationalize some of it. Like, maybe this was her plan all along. And I was like, this movie's just not doing that. That
was clearly not the plan. And it just kind of worked out that way.
It worked out that way. And that's kind of where I lost the thread a little bit in that movie. Mostly that, just mainly because I started getting down this tangent of, like, rationalization for it. When I was supposed to be having a little bit more fun with what they were just kind of the playground they were messing around in.
And I think that's kind of where we come back to our original point of, like, if this movie was able to nail the tone the whole way through, we wouldn't have that, like, trying to rationalize it in the real world.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, the only note that I would, like, even give it, not that they're asking for my notes, obviously, is that, like, the only real world character that I think this movie should have had was the cop.
And these girls are in for a very rude awakening in college when they hit a big city and their cops actually fingerprint DNA and check cameras.
Not only that, there was a fucking witness when they killed Josh Hutcherson. They were, like, right there next to the road and they didn't even move the body.
Nope.
So, like, that motorist who stops would just be like, those two girls were right there or that body was found.
And the fucking guy, the guy from Too Many Cooks walked in while they're chopping up the cheer captain.
He doesn't see that, though.
No. I know. That was such a great scene where you're just like, fuck, no, okay, we're okay.
The best thing about it was Chewie had never seen Too Many Cooks until recently, so when he walked in and saw that, I just go, Too Many Cooks, and she's like, that is him!
Yeah. That's nice. Great. When they turn on the light, the fucking head is spinning around. This can't be an accident now.
Yeah, I love that frustration of, like, they keep thinking they're accidents. It's like...
I really enjoyed when I saw that they were doing that in the movie. I was like, you could feed that premise for the rest of the runtime.
Yeah.
And I like that kind of mistaken, like, I'm trying to be bad, but no one will notice me.
And they were all mad when Josh Hutcherson turned out to be like, everybody said it was an accident. And they were like, fuck, dude, he was stabbed.
he was stabbed. Like, no, motorcycles are bad. Like, no!
It's a story about road safety, not a story about murder.
So great.
I loved when the cheer captain spotted the shoelaces and knew immediately who was attempting to murder her.
Michaela? Oh, shoot. I'm sorry. And she apologizes.
I think that's where I keep coming back to on this movie. Yeah. The things that it does well, it does so well that I can forgive all the things that I don't like about it, and including casting Craig Robinson, because he drives me up the fucking wall. But
he wasn't there long, and you got to see him get killed, so.
That, I didn't want to say that, but you did, and I'm going to agree with you.
I'll be the bad guy here. Yeah. It's fine.
I know a lot of people love Craig Robinson. I liked him in The Office. That's it.
That scene, that fight was, I don't know, throwing weights around.
That was awesome.
That was awesome.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, it's just like, it was impressive to see them fighting him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's really cool to see, yeah, two tiny teenage girls take on a big, big, bulky dude like
that. 6'6", 300 pounds, just huge.
Yeah, but they had to find clever ways to work together and do it, and it's great. And I love how, like, MK was just like, I had it. I was like, he probably didn't. I don't think that was
because of his size, the metabolism, like, it wouldn't have worked on him.
You had him in, like, 2 hours, maybe.
Yeah.
I just love her every attempt to get him to drink the bottled water.
She was hitting on him. It was so gross.
I like the, like, I need to go and inspect that sound. Do you want to take this with you?
Why don't we hydrate first?
The script is solid, man. Yeah, like, really it's good. A well-written movie. Let's talk a little bit more about MK. We've talked about Sadie to death, but MK is the true believer, if you will. She does not see the error in their way. She keeps trudging forward on the murder train.
I think she's the breakout. Like, Sadie's great, and she's obviously they want her to be the main character, but because MK gets to be 100% insane,
yeah,
I felt like her story was the more interesting one to follow anyway.
I agree, and I wish they'd done that more. I wish they'd spent more time with MK over Sadie.
Because, like, MK's emotional turns on the drop of a dime were so interesting to see. Like, right after Craig Robinson is killed and her mother comes in to tell her, you see her process the information. And then, like, a light switch flicks in her eyes and she goes straight to, like, what? No!
Oh, yeah.
I love fake acting in movies. Like, it always just cracks me up. Hers was perfect.
Yeah.
Like, oh, no, I can't believe he died. How did the weights hit his head? Mm-hmm. It's like,
nobody said anything about weights. Yeah. Hitting his head.
I wish we'd had more time with her. Like, I don't think this movie needed to be as trim as it was. And it could be budgetary. It could be a million reasons. But, like, it's a tight hour 32, I think. Like, I think it's like just right at the hour and a half. Like, it's a feature. And it's like, I feel like we hit in an hour 45 and spent 15 more minutes with Michaela to give them more of like a, this isn't Sadie's story with her best friend Michaela, it is their story, and had them a little bit more even keel.
Well, and I kind of wonder if this is kind of the editing influence on it. That, like, I don't know, and anything I do, even though it's not like movie related, I'm always trying to keep things concise and trim. Like, there's kind of this need to, like, keep the fluff away, and oftentimes it's like you couldn't put more. Like, it's always harder to put more in because it's like, well, we got to the point. Like, yeah. I think we got to the point. I think it was good enough. So there's kind of that kind of, I'm always battling with trying to add more stuff in.
Yeah.
When, like, we achieve the point sooner. So, like, that trimness is kind of like that a problem in that way, I guess. Because you're efficient, but maybe you don't have to be as efficient.
Well, it's inefficient to the point of detriment because it's like you're so efficient at telling the story that you want to tell that you're not assuming that your audience would want to see more. And it's like, okay, so you got the story that you want to tell in there. Perfect. You did great. But we still kind of feel like we missed out on something.
Right. Like personally, I have a problem with, like, breathing room in anything we're going to, like, there's always a note to be like, this can, you can space this out, you can give more.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, well, I'm in that mode of just get to it. I know the story. I know the narrative thread in this. Let's get there. Kind of like, it's like, but things can breathe. And I think in something that's funny, that has a comedic element, you need that breath, that kind of pause, the long, like, those moments more, just as much as you need the trim, like, quick jokes.
Like,
you need the room to laugh a little bit and to breathe.
I would have loved to see a scene of MK and Kimi killing someone, like them working together. Because we got it a little bit, like, he picks her up from the
teacher.
Yeah, they kill the teacher together.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know. I wouldn't want to see, like, more of, like, the plan. Kind of like how we saw with Sadie and, like, MK, like we're going to kill the cheer captain. Like, I wouldn't want to see that. Like,
wanted to see the initial thing that they came to him with, which was teach us how to do this efficiently. Mm, you want to see the actual montage sequence.
Yes, I want to see
that.
I would
have enjoyed that, too. Yeah,
I want to see him training them, because that's why they kidnapped him. And it was a really cool idea that they do nothing with.
And well, and that's why we get the joke about the pets, is because they're preparing, they're doing like kind of the mundane elements of this, like, mass murder.
Yeah,
it's like, oh, we got to burn the bodies, or we got to dissolve them, and it's like you get that joke from it.
Yeah,
and it's kind of nice to be able to have that preparation. You can find the funny in that.
Yeah, because even the teacher kill was more like Michaela killed the teacher, and he was just there. Like, he was just kind of window dressing of he showed up.
He helped corner the teacher.
Yeah, like it wasn't much of like the... Every time they killed somebody, they were very involved in everything. And he was just more... He was there. And like I would have liked to see them work together. I would have liked to see that... Almost like her frustrated with like... We kidnapped you because we thought you were the best at this. And you kind of suck. Like I would have liked to see that whole like...
Yeah.
She's dragging him along. Like, no, we're going to... Get the fuck over here. Like, what are you doing? Like, I would have liked to see that. Like, there's a really good scene in there somewhere of her and him together trying to make it work. And I just don't think we got it.
I liked that you saw that she came from a very privileged life.
Yeah.
So oh, that yeah. it wasn't like, well, I became a killer because of this thing that happened in my childhood. It's like, no, she's just wired to be a killer. There was no yep. other thing than that. She didn't have to be, like, molested as a child or see a man lit on fire or anything.
Very nice parents who were going to be really heartbroken when it finally comes out that their daughter's a murderer.
When they drive away and the parents are like, we did a good job. It's like, oh, you poor things.
There's no way these two girls can continue to murder people without getting caught. The day will come.
In this world,
I think they can. But
I think so, yeah.
Their parents are some of the only parents who still have children
from
that high school.
Oh my God, that's a good point. Like, everyone in this town is dead.
So, like, we did a good job. Yeah, because they're literally some of the only ones left alive.
Oh my God, I was immediately like, well, you guys are the only ones outside. Someone clearly locked all the kids in the gym. So clearly you're the ones who did it. And then no one apparently suspects
there's a fire extinguisher in the gym. I noticed this time around. I was like, somebody pick it up.
They're teenagers.
It doesn't matter.
I mean,
I want to survive in that situation.
Teenagers are dumb.
It's funnier that they missed it.
It would have been great just to cut to the fire extinguisher and have it be on fire like the IT crowd. Like, damn it. I mean, there are other classes. I mean, this was just the senior class. The juniors, sophomores, and freshmen.
No, the juniors were on the prom planning committee.
Oh, you're right.
This is a multi-generational prom.
Yep. So the sophomores and the freshmen are left to pick up the pieces.
Yeah. There's no graduation the year after.
Oh, my God.
Well, there is for two.
No.
The year after. Yeah, that one.
Oh, my God.
Well, some people don't go to prom.
That's true. Oh, wow. What a good time to be a nerd and nobody likes.
Is anyone going to notice the murder rates just stop after these two girls go to college?
I mean, with those police, no. Mm-hmm.
But he retired, so maybe someone competent.
He's not the only cop. Like,
it kind of felt like
it really
seems
did.
Like he is, yeah.
But it also feels like in this world, it's feasible that everyone is that cop.
Yeah.
And everyone, like, adult is that cop in terms of their ineffectiveness. Like, the adults suck in this. and for great humor. But, like, that's the world this is. And I think that I would believe that there could be another movie of this, them in college, and they could surprisingly get away with it.
I would watch. I would definitely watch a continuation of these two girls doing really anything, and like they could even do it like the original sequel to Trainspotting, or even the sequel to Trainspotting, where like it takes place later and they're not doing heroin anymore; they're doing something completely different, and it's this all other story. I would totally watch these two girls doing something else. Like, all right, we got done with murder. Now we do. Tax fraud. <It's> like, I would watch the hell out.
Suddenly have like you have the Italian job with them.
Watch a movie about tax fraud.
I mean, I probably not tax fraud necessarily, but like
two
I would
college
watch.
Girls do tax fraud. Sounds pitch.
I will watch that movie.
I'll buy it.
I would definitely watch it just because that's a ballsy pitch.
I'm gonna tell that to my manager and be like, "This is what I'm gonna go pitch," and he'll be like, "No."
But there's that sense in these types of movies, these comedic horror movies, especially like Tucker and Dale, where the world perceives everyone around the main characters, how that world sets them up, really kind of plays into the believability of it. And the fact that these people around these characters are so incompetent and just clueless makes sense and works.
Yeah. I would really like to see this director do more. Like, I'd like to see him do... It's a comic book that most people have heard of, not everybody. But if he could do this one, I think he'd be perfect for it. I'd like to see him do Hack Slash. I think he'd be awesome at Hack Slash. If you guys haven't read Hack Slash, I highly recommend it. It's awesome. It's all about a girl who is her main goal in life is to murder serial killers. So she is the slasher of, she's the hacker of the slashers. It's awesome. And they bring in like actual characters, like Chucky shows up for a while, Jason Voorhees shows up for a while. Like today, it's an awesome book. It's written by Tim Seeley. Highly recommend it to everybody. Tough to get down and do right. That's why whenever somebody else tries to write it, it goes horribly. I think this guy would be a good fit for this tone, and just based on this movie a lot, because the whole time I'm watching, I'm like, if this guy doesn't read Hack Slash, I would be surprised, because it just has a lot of the same sense of humor and tonality to it. It's not quite as like exploitive as Hackslash can be, but it's still in the same vein, and I think it'd be really cool to see him.
Although he has a writing credit on it, he's not the only writer, so to be fair, I suspect this script came to him and then he did a rewrite.
That's very possible. But either way, like, just the tonality of the movie, just the look, the feel, all of it, like...
I just want to give credit to the writers whose name I don't
know. I was going to say, what's their name?
Wow.
I want to give credit to the writers, whoever they are.
I want to give credit to John Smith, the writer of this movie. A dot writer.
Chris Lee Hill and others.
Others? What's that about?
Who's others?
Oh, Justin Olsen wrote the original screenplay.
Oh, okay. So yeah, Justin Olsen's the one who came up with the idea then.
Yeah.
Good for him.
And then the other two rewrote it into whatever we saw. So, what haven't we hit? What have we not talked about that you guys love? Beth, you're working costumes. Do you want to talk about the costumes?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Line where she's like, we're going to have to start wearing masks because we look so fabulous.
Yes. Okay. So first of all, when they kill the cheerleader and they're in their matching outfits and they had little like gaze at each other, I was just like, on point, guys. Way to get it. And then they have the line about masks and then follow through masks at the end. And I was like, way to go. I thought the like really the prom dresses were very like ethereal because you had the crisscross on the front and it was all very like wavy and it kind of brought you in to be like, oh, maybe she's okay. She looks very like, but she's not, which was a great flip of the coin. But what I really loved, and I think nobody noticed but me, and it only kind of has to do with clothes, is the Titanic-themed prom. They had little mannequins dressed up in old-timey clothes that you could be photographed with. And I was just like, yes, yes, yes. Thank you, someone. That is ridiculous.
That's a great detail.
Totally missed that.
Yeah, spectacular.
The design, like the details in this movie, like they made, I'm sure they didn't have a ton of money. They made it work.
Oh, absolutely. You could see every cent on the screen.
Yeah.
There's no one who's like hashed away part of the budget and is sleeping on a bed of money because of it. Yeah. Everybody used every cent.
Yeah, absolutely. And it worked. It worked really, really well. Anything else that we haven't hit? Or should we move into quotes? Sounds like we're moving into quotes.
Quotes. Was really, like, just a side note. I was really sure I was going to come to this table and have to defend this movie. I thought I was going to become Chewy and Geostorm and sit here with four people with hard eye rolls upset that I suggested this. So I'm really happy everyone has joined us.
No, dude, this is the fact that this was the week of the Kavanaugh hearing. I put this movie on because I was tired of watching that shit. And then I watched this and I was like, yes, these teenagers are murdering men and a couple women. Which I was like, I kind of wish it was just men, but
women were enabling the patriarchal society they lived in. So
probably true.
They're equal opportunity murderers.
Yeah. They don't discriminate. All right, let's move into quotes before I keep thinking about Kavanaugh and want to cry. Quotes.
Josh Hutcherson's whole bit was my favorite thing about this movie. He was fabulous. And, so there's a moment when they talk about their competing social media presences, and he's got a big one, and they're trying to convince him to link their shit on his shit. And he just says, look, I say what I feel. If people connect with it, that's beautiful. But I'm no hero. That is the most douchey line. It's so great.
I never thought I'd be a Josh Hutcherson fan, and just year after year, he keeps proving me wrong. Yeah. It's like, nope, I like this guy. Yeah. Fucking disaster artist who was so good. Like, well, I like him.
PETA is not funny. Josh is funny.
Yes. My quote also comes from Josh Hutcherson, and we've mentioned it earlier, and it's just, it brings me so much joy. He's about to die. He's getting murdered, and he just looks at me and goes, if I have to be murdered, I'm glad it's you. It's like, what the fuck?
She kisses his corpse.
It's like, you're on death's door. You don't need to keep being a douchebag. You can be mad now. It's okay.
Oh, and then when she drops his head, they made that sound extra loud. Oh, yeah. Too. Like, and just, that whole scene is just choice. Chef's kiss, as it were.
So good.
The quote from me that I thought was funny was when Jordan, the boy, was trying to give her an alibi out. It's like, oh, if anyone asked, we were watching a Dario Argento movie. And she's like, Dario DiGiorno. And he's like, no, Dario Argento. Dario Arpeggio. No, and then she's like, Mario Wario. I'm just like, the person who took film so seriously to be into those names back in the day, like, I had this, like, kind of it joined together, like those moments where it's like, I've been that person on either side. Now I'm the person on the side who would totally call Dario Argento Mario Wario and be fine with it. So but great. Like more college age me would be horrified. Like, how can you not take film seriously? And I had a personal connection to both sides of that conversation.
I picked two because I couldn't decide. It felt like a Sophie's choice. So I'm just giving you both. One of them is when they are being stalked by the killer once he gets loose. And one of them receives a call from their mother. Sweetie, there's someone who calls and just keeps breathing on the line.
Especially since we'd already seen her do that earlier.
She was so bad at it.
So bad. And I like how you went through the list of names of girls it might be.
Why am I four?
That's a good one.
And the others at the very beginning when the boy that they thought had been killed comes back to life on the table and they go kill him and they just turn back around and go, you're back down to four.
That was going to be mine. And then I just thought of the other one that I like Hutchinson so much more. But my secret hidden away quote that nobody would have just because I used to be obsessed with this movie was when he gives the DVD back to Sadie. He's like, oh, here's your movie back. Martyrs, man. It's really fucked up. And I'm like, oh, I love Martyrs. It's really fucked up, but I don't ever watch it anymore because it's basically just torture porn. But for a long time, that was like my favorite horror movie.
So Deep Pull is what you're saying.
Yeah, it was one of those. It's a French horror movie about two girls who become martyrs, and it's really fucked up and gross and awful, and I kind of recommend it. Nah.
Only kind. What a great double feature to this movie.
Yeah, they do not fit well. It's not like when you're reading Perks of Being a Wallflower, and they have that books of like that he's told to read, like, oh, these all fit tonality. Martyrs does not fit tonality.
But see, I love double features like that that don't fit tonality and just like but have that one element.
Yeah,
two women.
Yeah, yeah, okay, that works.
Yeah.
Review system for today. It's gonna be, I think, really easy. We'll see if you agree with me. Low budget movies. I'm gonna go first, and I'm gonna keep in the horror realm, and I'm going with Friday the 13th, one of my favorite movies of all time. I think it's one of the greatest horror movies ever made. I don't put this movie quite at that realm, but I want to put it on par because Friday the 13th makes me excited for everything that comes after Friday the 13th because it's might not be the best in the series, but it's a great movie, and without that one, I don't have the rest of it. And I look at Tragedy Girls, I'm excited for what everything these people do after this.
Okay.
It's a really good movie, and I want to see what comes next.
Okay. I've got one then based off of kind of that last sentence you just said. Tucker and Dale versus Evil. Because it's like, they're both very similar in terms of their irreverence and their way that they treat the characters surrounding the ones we're watching and just the absurdity and ridiculousness of it woven together so well.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with Final Girls. It's a movie about a bunch of people who are regular in real life and get sucked into a Friday the 13th-esque film, and it was independent, and it made almost no money, but it was very enjoyable to watch, and it was funny because they are aware that they're in the movie. So this one's not quite that funny and cohesive in story because that movie cheats a little. It uses the 90-minute format of a movie in it, inside of a movie, but this one's like, I don't know, two notches away, I think, from that.
I'd flip that. I think this was much better than Final Girls.
Really?
I liked Final Girls. I only liked it. I really liked this one.
Interesting.
Because I thought Final Girls was like, here's a great concept. What are you going to do with it? Not a lot. Okay.
I think Final Girls had more visual stuff that I got sucked in with.
Yes, it had a better budget.
Yeah, that's true.
I think it was low budget. It had some stars in it, so I don't know for sure, but Buffy the Vampire Slayer, the original movie.
Oh, totally low budget. Yeah.
Because it was, I thought about this like at the beginning, especially because Joss Whedon said his original intent was the idea of like, and this is how the show opens, is like the idea of that girl and you think she's the victim and then she flips it on its head and you realize that she's actually the badass. And in this, that's how this movie opened, is you're like, oh no, she's a victim. And then it was just like, oh, ha, just kidding. You know, she's in charge. I thought that was pretty cool.
No, just that poor guy gets the machete to the face and survives it. That poor guy. Like, to wake up with that headache, call an ambulance. They're on their way. Ouch.
And then he goes missing forever. There's never closure for his family.
This movie's really mean to everyone who isn't the two main characters.
And that's why I like it.
So that brings today's episode to a close. And we are just about done with our horror movie month. Just about. We have two more coming up, though, and I'm looking them up right now. Oh, no, we only have one more. I'm totally wrong. We only have one more week left after this. I can tell calendars. And that's going to be our Secret Santa movie battle, which we've done a number of times. We usually do it around Christmas, but I thought it'd be fun to do it for Halloween this year. So much like our other Secret Santa movies, our Secret Santa battles, it's not really a battle. We'll all be randomly assigned horror movies around the table, and Ooh. Then we have to try to guess who gave us that horror movie.
I'm struggling to choose between two very different movies.
Well, then wait to see who you get. That might help you decide.
That's kind of why I'm not even thinking about it until I get the name, and then I will just kind of free think it.
Is the idea, though, to get someone to like something you like, or is the idea to screw someone with something you know they initially would never watch but might open up to?
Or just to annoy them with a horrible movie. I've done that. Chewie did that to me.
I gave Chewie Battleship, and she's very upset about that.
Yeah, she still hasn't forgiven her.
I love Battleship, so I thought I was doing something nice.
You thought you were doing her solid.
Yeah, I was like, this movie's really enjoyable.
I gave her Kroll once, and she liked Kroll. Kroll was awesome, though. But next week for that episode, we do have a very special guest coming back. Not special in the way of celebrity or anything like that, but he was the original co-host of After the Hype. So we have Nicholas Friedemann coming back to join us for an episode. Back when it just used to be me and him in my bedroom on the floor with a Nagra between us trying to make this show work.
Oh, yeah.
And then he fucked off to Canada to go make video games. Ugh. But now he's back in LA and he's going to join us for
free healthcare and a working democracy.
Why would you ever come back?
And an attractive.
Oh, my God. Yes.
Very attractive.
Yeah. Fucking bullshit country. Come on, man. But yes, he will be back. He is excited for it. Or at least he told me he was 2 seconds ago and asked me if he wanted to be on it.
Yeah, I'm excited. Yeah. Damn it. Yeah. I thought I could escape.
And then the week after that, we're finally going to talk about a movie that I've been waiting to talk about for a long time.
Talk about a horror month.
I can't wait to watch this horrible garbage. And we're watching Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom.
Pretty bad.
I've heard.
Hard pass, guys.
I watched it in the theater.
Ouch. Yeah. Didn't you watch the first Jurassic World on the back of a chair on a plane?
Yes.
Yeah. How'd you think it would be better the second time around?
It wasn't my choice.
Okay, that makes sense.
No, I think I was given some options and I picked it because there's sometimes when you want to watch something stupid and you know it's going to be stupid, but you kind of think maybe it will be fun.
I am so excited to watch it based on that review.
Nice.
But that's it for today. So we should say a big thank you to Beth for coming out.
Thank you, Beth.
Thanks for having me.
Do you have anything you want to plug really quick?
No.
Perfect. And I'm going to skip all my plugs. Listen to last week's episode if you want to hear them. I want to go home. Oh, I will let Emily.
That's it. This is a bio coat.
Bio coat, Emily
just
Blake
any
Sews.
Coat. Just go to a Goodwill and
just
buy
go
a
to a
coat.
Store and buy a coat.
Yeah. Buyacoat.com.
It's like November-ish now. Just go buy a fucking coat.
For God's sake, get warm.
Bye.
Bye.